So first of all, I want to thank the organizers for inviting me. It's really a pleasure to be here. And I really enjoyed being here for a few days now. And it's okay. So I'm going to talk about a joint work with Jacob Bedrossian and Pierre Germain. So Jacob is in Maryland, Pierre Germain is also at NYU. And this is about hydrodynamic stability. So it's long, I mean, it is related, I think, to the talk of Carlos, because it's also about understanding something about long time behavior, but here in fluid equation. So hydrodynamic stability at high Reynolds number. So maybe this is a slightly different, I mean, it is exactly the same title, but I wanted to insist on the high Reynolds number, and I'll explain that. So what is our starting point here? The starting point is the Navier-Stokes equation. So let me write down the Navier-Stokes equation. I'm going more or less to assume that people are familiar with this. So I'm not going to recall Navier-Stokes and so on. So if you are not familiar with that, okay, try to read a little bit about it or maybe ask me questions. So this is the equation we'll be looking at. So V is the velocity, P is the pressure, and we are incompressible, so the divergence of V is zero. And we take this with an initial data. OK, so this is the equation. This is the equation we are interested in. So immediately now, I'm going to decide what is the domain, the type of domain I'm going to look at. OK? So again, a new is what I call the Reynolds number minus 1. So this is the viscosity, which will be bigger or equal than 0. When nu is equal to 0, we recover Euler equation. Right? Nu equals 0 is the implicit case that corresponds to Euler equation. So here, v is a function of t and x, and it is in Rd, d will be 2 or 3 in our case. So we are either in dimension 2 or in dimension 3. Okay, so I'm going to use the following notation in terms of how I denote the 3 component of the velocity. So my v will be either, will be like either v1, v2. So it's not a square, but it's more the 3 components, or depending on which case we are, it will be either this or this. So this if we are in 2 dimensions, and this will be if we are in 3 dimensions. OK. So usually, whenever we look at the Navier-Stokes equation or Euler, we'll be also talking about boundary conditions. Here, I'm going to take really like the simplest example where there's no boundaries. So my domain will be in dimension 2, if I am in d equal to my domain. So maybe I should say that x is in here. I will say x is in some domain omega. My domain omega will be the torus times r. And if I am in dimension 3, my domain will be the torus times r times the torus. OK, I'll explain why I'm taking this. So this means that X is in the torus, Y is in R, X, Y, Z. Okay? So then in that case, I don't have to specify boundary conditions, except the fact that I will require functions to be periodic in X and periodic in Z. Okay? Okay. So now the question we are interested in here is to try to understand the asymptotic stability of the simplest possible non-trivial stationary solution. Okay, so the question is, of course, V equals zero is a stationary solution, but okay, we can understand the stability of that, and that will correspond to like small data, global existence, or things like that. But then we want to go one step further and consider non-trivial stationary solution. So now, for the Navier-Stokes equation, the simplest non-trivial stationary solution is the Couette flow. So we are interested in the stability of Couette flow. Okay, so what is the Couette flow? So let me write it down first in 2D. So if we are in 2D, the Couette flow corresponds to the case where V normally now is a function of X and Y. And with my notations, here V will be Y0. Okay? So if you take your velocity to be Y0, and you plug that into the equation, this gives you a stationary solution. Okay? The Laplacian just vanishes, and V grad V also vanishes there. Okay? So everything actually, all the terms vanish, right? Okay. So same thing in dimension three. In dimension three, the Couette flow will be Y0, 0. Okay.
It's periodic in the.
Yeah. So it's periodic. So Y is in the whole space.
Yes.
Y is in the whole space, but X and Z are periodic. Okay, so the flow, the way you have to think about the flow, I can draw it in two dimensions. So if this is my X, this is my Y. So if I am in two dimensions, the way you have to think about your flow is it is a flow like that. Okay, this is your flow, right? So maybe I can draw it like. It only depends on Y, right? It only depends on Y, but it is about the first component, right? That's also a reason why it is divergence free, because when you compute dx of Y is zero, so it is divergence free. Okay, so this is what we are interested in, is to understand the stability of this stationary solution. More precisely, we are more interested in long-time behavior. We are more interested in asymptotic stability. So I want to perturb this and prove that when t goes to infinity, I converge back to my stationary solution. Okay. Okay. So this is more or less the question that we want to address. So. Let me just say one thing before. If nu is equal to zero, so namely if we are in the Euler case, right? If I am in the Euler case, actually this stationary solution comes with a whole family of other stationary solutions which are called shear flows. Okay, so. I mean, in the case of Navier-Stokes, this is actually like an isolated stationary. I mean, you can multiply it by a constant, add a small constant. I'm not considering that. But the only type of stationary solutions for the Navier-Stokes case, I mean, it has to be an affine function here, so that the Laplacian vanishes. But if you are in the Euler case, I mean, all shear flows. Shear flows are stationary solutions. So basically, anything of the type phi of y zero, where phi is any function you can think about, let's say, has enough smoothness so that you can define things. These will be also stationary solutions, okay? But if you want it to be also a stationary solution for Navier-Stokes, then you want phi of y to be an affine function, okay? Okay, so, I mean, there is a small... this is important difference between the two cases because it tells you what you can expect when t goes to infinity, right? It turns out like in the case of Euler, if you take this stationary solution and you perturb it, I mean, you can perturb it a little bit by something of this type, and then you stay there. So in the case of Euler, you should not necessarily expect that necessarily you go back to what you started with, right? Because you have a whole family of stationary solutions which are just close to your Couette flow. Whereas in the case of Navier-Stokes, if you start from this, you perturb it. Of course, now when you perturb it and you keep the behavior at infinity the same, then I cannot really perturb it by multiplying by constant close to one or adding small constant because I'm fixing the behavior at infinity. So then in that case, I should expect maybe that I will go back to this. Okay, so that's more or less at least the goal of what I want to talk about in these three courses. Okay. Should I keep? Yeah, maybe I can write here.
You have a third one.
Oh, yeah. Let's use the third one there. Okay. Now. Okay. So. So basically, what I would like to do is to take V and write it down as my Couette flow plus a small perturbation. So let me now use notation in three dimensions. So I'll be going sometimes working with two dimensions, sometimes working with three dimensions. But basically, let me do notations in three dimensions. So then I'm going to write my V as y 0, 0 plus u. So u is the small perturbation. So think of u as small perturbation. Small perturbation. Okay. Now, it's a small exercise. Small exercise to rewrite the equation satisfied by u, right? So it's a small exercise to rewrite and basically, I mean, the whole exercise is just the nonlinear term. You have v grad v. V grad v now becomes four terms. One of them disappears, which is when you do the Couette flow, you put it twice, that disappears. And then you get some other terms. So then let me write it down what we get in that case. Let me write it down this way. Y dx u. So u is a vector, right? I mean, you have to keep in mind that u is a vector. I'm not putting necessarily the arrow on top of it. Okay, so it turns out that there is another term here that comes, minus U2, 0, 0, plus U grad P. Okay? Okay, so I mean, this is just the term that comes. I mean, there is a term like U2, 0, 0, but I wrote it on the other side. Okay? Yeah.
Is the sign on the Laplacian wrong? Mm-hmm. That looks like anti-diffusion.
Yeah. You are right. Okay, thank you. Okay, so yeah, I mean, I keep sometimes switching from where I write things. So right. That's a good. Okay, so this is the equation. This is the equation, and I mean, like, you have to think a little bit about where this comes from. I mean, just comes from. In your term V grad V, right? So you have a term V grad V, and in this term, if I put here U grad Y 0 0, right? If you look at this term, this gives you a U2 on the second component, right? So this is equal exactly to U2, 0, 0, right? Okay? So again, I mean, this is your
it's an indices.
Yeah. I insisted on that. V1, V2, those are indices. Like,
it's not a power.
I did it in purpose to write to insist on that there. Okay, so so this is the equation now we are looking at, right? So the question is the following. So I want to understand. I take this equation. I take a U which is an initial data for U which is small, and some U0 or U initial. And the question is, can I prove that if U0 in some norm is small, then I have global existence here, then I have a global solution. Then we have a global solution that remains small or remains under control and goes back to zero. We have a global solution U. And U of t goes to zero and t goes to infinity. Okay, so that's more or less the type of question. Here, I was not precise in writing down the equation, because what will be important here is the norms in which norm I am small. Okay? So there are two questions. I mean, there are at least two important questions, is which norm and what do I mean by small? What do I mean by small? And it turns out that if you fix the viscosity, the question is not difficult. Like if you have a fixed viscosity, then it's true that the statement is correct, and that was known from a long time ago. And I think, I mean, it was known even like in the 19th century, the end of 19th century. This is related to questions that people were interested in basically the end of 19th century, like people like Reynolds, Rayleigh. These are questions that they were interested in, and there were even experiments about it. And during that period, there was something called Sommerfeld paradox, and the Sommerfeld paradox is exactly related to the question we want to consider here. Basically, it's the fact that if you linearize the equation, and I'll be talking about the linearized problem, if you linearize your equation, then you expect to have linear stability. But on the other hand, people doing experiment were not really able to see the Couette flow as something that they can consider to be stable, right? And the reason, which I think is related to the result I'll be presenting here, is the fact that the smallness here will depend on the viscosity, right? So the smallness depends on the viscosity. So if we should stop for 1 minute. Okay, so the question is how to relate the norm here to the smallness here. Okay, so now in the physics literature, it's more recent terminology. If I try to rewrite the question, it's more or less the following. So given a norm, that I'm going to call an initial norm, mathematically this will be either Sobolev or Gevrey. So for us it will be Sobolev or Gevrey. I'll give you an exercise. I think since we have many students, I'll give you an exercise about Gevrey norm. So it will be either Sobolev or Gevrey. In the physics literature, this will they will be calling rough data and smooth. I think they consider analytic. But it turns out the mathematical result works also with Gevrey. I'll say a few things about that. So then the question will be the following. So what is the smallest gamma bigger or equal than zero such that if your initial data in your initial norm is smaller than nu to the gamma. So here, much smaller means, I should write it down, smaller than some fixed constant, but this constant can be small. So what is the smallest gamma such that if you start like that, then your u of t f, like your final, this will be like the initial, this will be the final, stays less than 1 for all time. And it goes to 0. So more or less, this is how you should understand the the problem we want to address. And gamma will have a name. Gamma will be called stability threshold, right? So gamma will be the stability threshold, and I mean this is in recent years it has been studied a lot in the physics literature. Maybe I call it stability of course the reason this is called the stability threshold, I mean, like, if you try to find the optimal gamma, what you should also expect, we also expect that we can find initial data, we can find initial data such that U0 initial is larger than some nu to the gamma, and we have instability. And there exists a time t. There exists a time t that depends, of course, on the viscosity, such that u at time t in this final norm is larger than some fixed number delta, okay? Becomes of order one in finite time, right? Okay, so basically this is what one should one should try to prove, basically. I mean, even though, like, we are not able to prove all this, but this is how one should try to characterize the optimal gamma, like, which is like the optimal size of your initial perturbation. So you have a size of initial perturbation. If you start smaller than that size, then you get stability, and you get also asymptotic stability, and you can find some candidates which are slightly larger, or which are exactly at the boundary, for which you don't have stability. Okay. Okay. So that's more or less the how we should ask the question. So it turns out for some technical reasons. I mean, like. I mean, it's not technical, but I think it's important. I mean, one has to think a little bit about it, that this type of result, we will be able to prove such kind of result, but with another condition, with the fact that this has to be smaller than some other, with some gamma prime less than gamma. Okay, so we will be able to give results of this type, but I will not allow my initial perturbation to be very large, right? It has to be still under control, and the reason is that the way you have to understand this result is really you have to follow your solution till it reaches the size one. So then I have to start really small so that I can follow it. Okay, so let me write down few results, and I think this is like a table that Pierre wrote when he gave his talk. So I'm going to redo the same thing. So what do we know about this problem as of now? So I will draw a table to tell you what we know. Okay, so if we are in dimension two, if we are Gevre, Sobolev, will have. So in dimension 2, if we are in Geoffrey, we know that gamma is equal to 2. Gamma is equal to 0. And we can take gamma to be 0. In the case of Sobolev, we know that gamma is less or equal than 1/2. So what I mean by less or equal than 1/2, it means that we don't have the second part. Like we don't know whether this is the optimal gamma or not. In dimension 3, in Geoffrey, gamma is equal to 1. And in Sobolev, gamma is less or equal than 3/2. Okay. Okay. So this is more or less the table. I mean, there are different works about these. Right. So yeah. Let me not now. Give names, but I'll get to giving names and so on.
Just for a question, do you have a bound from below in this number of case?
No.
It just means an example.
No. So basically, like in the Sobolev case, we only have this type of result. We don't have this one, and there is a reason behind it. There is a reason behind it, is that like this type of results in the Geoffrey case is that you are constructing precisely a way how the solution is going to grow, and you are controlling precisely how this growth is happening, right? So you are starting large, enough, basically, because you are starting like you'll be starting like at this size or at this size, so you can really follow it. In the Sobolev case, you have to be even much smaller because of the nonlinear term. The nonlinear term in this case is worse, right? So then you may have nonlinear effects that you don't control. So then, as of now, all what we can prove is that you can prove the stability part, but whether that is optimal or not, we don't know. So basically, it means that in the Geoffrey case, you can decide, you can compute precisely what is the instability route, how you go from being small till being size 1. You can follow it completely in the Geoffrey case. In the Sobolev, nonlinearity become more important, and maybe there are other nonlinear effects that makes the picture different. So that's the reason, basically. Okay. Other questions or? Yes.
Where does the expectation come from that there should be such a scaling with the viscosity at all?
That's a good. That's what you observe. So, but I think I would say, like, the physics literature, people realized this some time ago, and they started thinking about that. And I would say, like, in the end of the 19th century, people were not thinking in this way, I guess. And that's how the paradox started. Like there was a real paradox that, I mean, people can read about it. Like you can type Sommerfeld paradox and it will come exactly about this question. Like, I mean, you have a flow at the linearized level. At the linearized level, you expect it to be stable, but it's not something you can observe easily in experiments. And the reason is that the perturbation you can allow are very, very tiny compared to the viscosity. And okay, so I think it's not that difficult to guess that that's really the right way of I mean, now maybe if, it's not difficult. Like if you start playing with the equation, it's not difficult to guess that that's really the right way of asking the question. But I don't have a one thing one can do is if you look at the linearized problem, and you try to study the linearized problem has a dissipative effect, right? And the dissipative effect is based on the viscosity, right? So you expect that if you have a larger viscosity, you have more dissipation, so then you can allow larger perturbations, right? I think it makes sense, right? Other questions?
Sorry, I might have missed this, but what is that norm with the F?
So here I'm not very precise yet on deciding norms, in which norm I'm looking. It turns out that the choice of norm here will depend actually on the coordinate system I use. So if I don't do anything with the coordinate, if I keep the same xy, here I will only allow things like L2 or maybe H1.
So it's not necessarily the same norm.
No, but actually I'm not going to be working in my original coordinate system. I will make a change of coordinate. And then this norm will be actually the more or less the same Jouvray or the more or less the same Sobolev norm. So it's L2 in the original. Or here Jouvray or Sobolev in after change of variable. Okay. This is easy to understand. I'll explain it. After change of variable. I mean, it's really the next thing I'm going to talk about, which is the necessity of using a change of variable in this problem.
Okay. So your table does not depend on the number of derivatives in a Sobolev norm.
So here what I mean by Sobolev, it means Sobolev with S large enough. I think in the papers, more or less, we didn't really try to optimize what is the Sobolev you need, but it's more or less like around 4 or 5 derivatives. I think it's true that it's an interesting question to ask, okay, what happened in energy space, for instance? I don't know, right? I think that will be also a question to ask. But here, Sobolev means, let's say, HS S larger than 5, let's say. Okay? I mean, we have to spend some derivatives. I mean, the whole proof uses regularity. I mean, one of the ideas about the proof is that use regularity for decay. I mean, there will always be this sort of theme. And so we have to lose a little bit of derivatives in the statements. Okay, other questions? I saw, no? Yeah.
What are the Jouvray norms?
Okay, so there is an exercise I'm going to give you now. So Jouvray is, I think he's French or Italian?
French,
okay. No, Maurice Jouvray, yeah. So I think he's, I mean, the paper is 1980, yeah. So Jouvray regularity is something which lies between C infinity and analytic, right? So somehow, I mean, if you think about regularity, if you think about analytic as being very regular, you have C infinity here you have analytic. You want to put things in between, right? So putting things in between meaning that, okay, you have to quantify in a way the C infinity regularity, and here you get some Gevre. And the exercise I want to give you, I mean, the reason behind this exercise, even though I think I'm not going to use it, is that in the last few years, there were many few papers about, especially in fluid, using the Gevre regularity. And some of them use the Fourier site of the Gevre regularity, and others use the physical site. And, like, it's not an easy exercise. I mean, like, okay, I mean, it's not completely trivial to see that these two sides are the same, right? That the space is the same. But I mean, since I think it's a nice exercise and it may be useful, so let me give you this exercise. So I think the original definition of Gevre, is based on saying that, okay, f. So let me just write it for one variable x. So one variable x, which is in the torus. What do we mean by f is Gevre of class 1 over s? OK, so this is another thing which is not why I write it 1 over s, because I want s to be between, my s will be between 0 and 1. So 1 over s is bigger than 1, OK? 1 over s is bigger than 1. 1 over s equal 1, this is analytic. And 1 over s, 1 over s large. So when 1 over s gets larger, the space gets weaker, OK? So that's why I prefer to use s. I prefer to use s than 1 over s, but the definition is, say that f is Gevre of class 1 over s if the following holds. If f is C infinity, so you can take any number of derivatives, and if you take for all x in the torus, let's say we are in the torus, if I take j derivatives, it will grow like some derivative grow in the following way, j factorial to the power 1 over s, and there is a tau to the power j. And there exists C0 and tau. So f is Gevre of class 1 over s if f is C infinity, and there exists C0 tau positive, such that for all x in your torus, if you take j derivatives, your j derivative can grow in this manner. Okay. So you can observe that if 1 over s is equal to 1, that's analytic. If 1 over s is large, you are allowing derivative to grow more, right? So the larger 1 over s, if 1 over s gets larger and larger, your space is closer and closer from just being C infinity, okay? So it's a way of quantifying, how derivative grow, okay? Okay, so this is a physical side definition. This is a physical side definition of the Gevre regularity. Okay, so now the exercise is to prove that this is actually equivalent to the following fact. Now, as I said here, I am in the torus, so my f, I can look at the Fourier transform, And of course, since here I am in the torus, my Fourier transform will go from Z to C. Okay? And this is actually equivalent to the fact that there exist constants now, C0 and C. So the C0 here and there are not necessarily the same. Exponential minus C, k to the power s. Okay, so basically the exercise is to prove that if f satisfies this with some C0 and tau, then it satisfies this with some C0 and C. Okay? So it's a way of quantifying how the Fourier transform decays. Okay? And it's not difficult to see that the constant C being big is like tau being small. Like C is big is like tau small. Okay?
These are point-wise bounds, correct?
So, right. So here, the way I wrote it here, I mean, the way the definition of the space is a C infinity, is an L infinity. I mean, like, if you think about it this way, this is like an L infinity. This is an L infinity type space, right? You are thinking about it as an L infinity type space. In the way I'm going to use it, I'll be using an L2 type space, right? So, so I can, I mean, it's a good, I mean, your question is perfect because that's really what motivates then the choice of the norms. Let me just give me 1 second before I go into the norms. When S is equal to 1, this is exactly the analytic case. And C will be just the radius of analyticity, right? So when S is equal to 1, so we are in the analytic case, and C will be like the radius of analyticity. Yeah, my handwriting maybe is getting worse. Okay. So I leave this exercise for you. Maybe next tomorrow, maybe I'll start by sketching very fast how you can prove this. Or maybe someone, if someone wants to do it in 5 minutes tomorrow, that will be good. Right. So yeah, so as I said, this is an L infinity based norm. I mean, the way I'm going to state things, which will be more like with L2 based norms, and basically the type of norms I'll be talking about when I say they're Jeuvrey, I mean the following thing. I will take S to be actually 1/2, and that's, we think it is the optimal thing, even though I will say, like, in the 2D and the 3D, even though the S is the same, S is 1/2, but it's for completely different reasons. I mean, there's no clear reason why it's the same. And okay, I mean, that was like, I think it's more like a coincidence than a deep reason. And the norm will be, okay, so let me write it in 2D. I'm going to consider D equal 2 because at least it will start fix. I will start fixing notations. So now I have a function of x, y. Remember that x is in the torus, y is in the whole space. So f hat will be a function of k eta. K is in z, eta will be in r. I mean, if I put z also, let me put z so then I can fix notation for the whole. Okay, so that's the Fourier. And as I said, I'll be using more the Fourier side of it. So it's more like this sort of decay. But I don't like using L-infinity-based spaces. I want to use L2-based space because I'll be using energy estimates, things like that. So an L2-based space here will be, so normally I have an S and I have a radius, right? S will be fixed in the whole proof. So basically, I don't need to really specify it. So, but it will depend on lambda. Lambda is related to the weight you see here. So the norm is you just sum over LK in Z. You integrate for eta in R. And then you take F hat square. And now I put a weight, exponential 2 lambda. Unfortunately, I'm not having enough space here. K eta L square d eta. OK? That's more or less the L2-based norm for lambda bigger than 0. I mean, think of lambda as being the C here, maybe slightly smaller than the C, right? So if you have a C here, if you take a lambda slightly smaller than the C, then that will be an L2-based norm, for your Jouvre space. This is not square. This is S. Okay, that's S. S is the exponent I have here. The reason, I should be writing S here, but like in the whole lectures, the S will be like fixed. I said S equal 1/2, but it's like strictly bigger than 1/2. 1/2 is like the threshold, but we cannot reach it. But S will be fixed. Lambda will change with time. Like I will start with a lambda, and then I can allow lambda to become weaker. So I can allow C to change, right? So these are spaces with two. I mean, like it's really, one has to think of them as saying that S is fixed is like you think that your Sobolev norm is fixed, but you can allow your norm to grow. And basically, instead of allowing my norm here to grow, I will be keeping norm under control. I will allow lambda to shrink, to be smaller and smaller, right? So in a statement like that, the reason I'm having an initial and a final, the final is really allowing the lambda to getting smaller, right? But getting smaller with time in a controlled way and so on. OK, so any other questions about the norms? Yes.
So you are making this assumption that you're working in a periodic case with respect to those two variables. How important is that, and what happens if you don't do it?
Okay. So two remarks. Yeah. So basically there are two things. Why do the whole space in Y? So if I don't do the whole space in Y, I cannot do periodic in Y because Y is not a periodic function. But the more natural question is to try to study something between, like, let's say Y equals 0 and Y equals 1, let's say, and you have your flow like that. I mean, like, experiments will be doing this, right? So if you do that, the issue, mathematically, there are tremendous issues. I mean, then you have other problems due to boundary layers, right? So this has to do with boundary layers, and the problem, the question becomes completely different. And there is a whole literature about this. So that's not the goal of what I'm going to talk about here. But like even doing the limit between Navier-Stokes and Euler in in the case is an open problem to understand what happens here. So that's about why we take white in the whole space. I mean, there is also, I think there is a physical reason even, I mean, we want now to insist about it. Actually, the 2D model, especially the 2D model, seeing like the fact that we have 2D Euler, 2D Euler is more related to problems coming even like from plasma physics. So in plasma physics, there are set of variables for which your plasma will behave exactly like 2D Euler. And I think it comes more in cases where more or less you should not be having boundaries, even though I'm not maybe very familiar with that. But I think the model itself, 2D Euler in this set of, in this geometry, I think is more motivated from plasma physics than from fluids. Okay, so that's the first. That's about why we take Y in the whole space. So now, why X in the periodic? I mean, there are issues. If you take X in the whole space, you get issues with low frequencies. So there are low frequency issues. So that's why we prefer to take it in a periodic setting. And also, it shows better the idea of mixing that I'm going to talk about. I mean, like the whole proof is based on mixing, and you understand mixing better in the periodic setup. I mean, it's not completely impossible that these results still work in the whole space in X. I mean, I think there should be some other version of that. But as of now, there is a paper. There is a paper that we posted with Jacob and Muho. So there's a paper with Jacob and Muho about the Landau damping in the whole space. I mean, I was not planning to talk about it right now, but maybe at the end. But there is, I mean, this problem is, there is a brother to this problem, which is the Landau damping, right? Landau damping for the Vlasov-Poisson, for the Vlasov case. For Vlasov-Poisson, I mean, this was, I mean, related to the work of Muho and Villani about Landau damping. And in this case, I mean, we have like X and V. X usually is considered in the torus, V in the whole space. This is like the work of Muho Villani. They work in this case. Exactly the reason X is in the torus is the same reason my X here is in the torus. And then we have a paper now with Muho and Jacob doing X in RD. And the whole difficulty is studying low frequencies. There's issues with low frequencies and so on. Okay, so other questions? I still have how 15 minutes. Okay, good. Yeah, I think I went much slower than what I wanted to do, but I think that's okay. So right. So I think what I'm going to do now is maybe give you like a small plan of what I intend to do, even though maybe I will not be able to do the whole plan, but anyway. So so the proofing results of this, so as of now, I'm not going to give statements. More or less, the statements are, I think you can, I mean, if you take any one of those spaces, the way I wrote them there, the way I gave you the exercise, I mean, you use a norm like that. More or less, you see what type of statements I want to prove. But the reason I'm not stating the statement right now, there are also change of variables that I have to do the right way and so on. But so that's why I'll first start by trying to give you linear dynamics first, right? So the okay. So I'll start by 2D. So what do I mean by linear dynamic? Okay. So if you have this problem, first of all, you want to understand the linear problem, and then from understanding the linear problem, you can try to do something about the nonlinear problem. So in 2D, actually, what we do, we look at the vorticity. And it turns out linear dynamics, so first 2D. So we look at the vorticity. So again, the vorticity, for those who are not very familiar, the following quantity. And then it turns out that now, if you write your equation on the vorticity, the U equation, so you remember I had a U equation that I just erased. The U equation, maybe it's, yeah, no, I think I erased it. Oh, no, it's here. Okay, good. Okay, so if I take the curl of this equation, right? If I take this equation and take the curl of it in 2D, what I get, as of now, let me write it for the nonlinear problem, but then immediately I'll be looking at the linear problem. What you get the following equation. Okay. I mean, this is an easy exercise. I'm not going to do it. If I am in the, I mean, this is the nonlinear term. The nonlinear term is here. This is the nonlinear term. So if I just want to look at the linear, if I just want to look at the linear problem, these are the linear terms. Okay, those are the linear terms. So actually, in the 2D case, this equation is very interesting because I can recover u from omega. So all I have to do is just, there is a scalar variable that I have to study, and I can recover u from omega by the Biot and Savart law, so the fact that u is the grad perp of Laplacian minus 1 of omega. Okay? Grad perp means minus dy dx Laplacian minus 1 of omega. Okay. I mean, this is at the nonlinear level. At the linear level, this disappears, and they just get a transport diffusion equation for omega. This happens only in 2D. In 3D, things get more complicated. But it turns out that in 2D, this is a very interesting quantity, and it simplifies things tremendously. And I think most of the differences between the two cases is due to the fact that in 2D, we have a scalar. It's like a scalar problem, basically. In 3D, there is more. OK, so now, OK, I mean, you have this equation. You have this equation about the vorticity. What is the natural thing to do? What is the natural thing to do? So even if I am in the Navier, even if I am in the Euler, in the Euler case, this will not be there, and I will just get this term, right? So the natural thing to do, if you see an equation like this, the natural thing to do is to make a change of variable, right? To get rid of that transport term, because like this transport term gives you growth of norms, but for a wrong reason, maybe. Like it's just because things are rotating a lot, turning around. I mean, it's an easy exercise to check that if you take just this transport equation and you consider high Sobolev norms, they will be growing because of this y here. So the natural change of variable, so let me now forget about this term. I'm just going to study the linear problem. So basically, I'm going to study, I just want to explain a few things about the following equation at the linear level, right? So again, here, so now we are in 2D. So remember, my x is in the torus. My y is in the whole space. And I will be thinking sometimes with the viscosity, sometimes without the viscosity, to understand different effects, some inviscid effect and some viscous effect. So first of all, the change of coordinate consists, I mean, I would like to get rid of this. So the change of variable is just this one. So this is the natural change of variable, because then if I make this change of variable and consider capital U to be and my omega Yeah, I think, okay, let me keep the nonlinear term so that at least you can see the change of variable at the nonlinear level, and then I will just. So if I do the change of, if I take this equation, you'll see how the nonlinear term transforms, and I make this change of variable, then the equation I get is the following thing. So, I get an equation on this capital omega to be up on this gradient phi. Okay, let me explain now what are the notations. So grad u becomes grad L of capital U. Laplacian u becomes Laplacian L of capital U, and grad L is the following, dx dy minus t dx. Okay? So it's an easy change of variable. I mean, this is type of things you will do. You explain student in calculus how derivative in y, so if I take a derivative in y, a derivative in small y is like a derivative in capital Y minus t times the derivative in capital X. Okay? Okay, makes sense. And then Laplacian L is just this square. Okay, and phi is like the stream function in the new coordinate system. So Laplacian L phi is omega. Okay, so that's for the nonlinear term, to understand the nonlinear term. If I were in the linear case, this will not be there. I will just get dt omega equal this. Okay. Okay, so this is a small exercise. Again, like you can, you can make this change of variable. I think it's a good exercise of change of variable. Take your omega to be the solution of this with u given by this formula. Make the following change of variable and prove that big omega will be solving the following equation with the following things. Okay? The gradient here means gradient in capital X, in capital X, capital Y. Just a small remark, at the nonlinear level, there is here a hidden important cancellation, which I will, I mean, we use in this work, we use sometimes the terminology like null conditions to mimic the same type of things that are observed in dispersive equations, like to mention like derivatives that behave in a good way. And here there is one aspect of that at the nonlinear level, even though I want to explain it a little bit very fast. You see, there I have gradients with L sometimes. I mean, maybe the notation is somehow confusing. But when you see a derivative hitting small u, this means small x, small y, right? These are small x, small y. If you see a derivative hitting capital U, it means large x, large y. But then these derivatives, the natural way they transform into these derivatives with this sort of growth, right? But then an interesting observation is that if you take the following term, so the following term has, there's a derivative that comes from here and a derivative that comes from here, right? So basically there is a term of this type. Psi is the stream function, so psi, I will call Laplacian psi is omega here. So normally this, when I transform it, if I transform it, it should become, right? If I use exactly that rule. Okay, but then, I mean, it's not difficult to see that actually there is a cancellation here, and this becomes this. At the nonlinear level, this is very important that this happens like that. Okay. I mean, the and this is a nice nonlinear cancellation. I mean, it's just the following fact. I mean, if you think about it this way, so this is this one, and the other one is here. Okay, so you see that this times this, and this times this, they cancel. So somehow this guy and this guy, they cancel. Right, so that's why from the L I can get rid of it. Right, so this was an important observation because, I mean, it's one of many actually other important cancellation coming from the specific nonlinear term. So basically what this means that if instead of taking the right Navier-Stokes, if you come and you choose a different nonlinearity, then a cancellation like this will not be there. And then I don't know how we can manage, right? Okay, so whenever you tell me to stop, I stop. I mean, because I mean, I am in the middle of small calculations, but I think I am good. I think that's where, because then I will start talking. No, because then I'm going to start talking about enhanced dissipation. So this is another good exercise for those who want to do exercises. I gave two exercises, but change of variable and the exercise about Geoffrey norms.
Okay, great. Thank you, Nader. You have many questions.
Other questions? Yeah, I can take another question. Yeah.
What do you expect to happen to the pressure? The pressure, because for the Couette flow is zero, right? So what did you happen? What do you expect to happen to the pattern?
For the pressure?
Yes.
Okay, so I think, okay, so this is a good question in terms of, okay, what happened to the pressure? It turns out in this problem, so maybe the way I answer the question, in many problems about Navier-Stokes and Euler, the pressure you completely ignore it because you think of it as a Lagrange multiplier, and in many, here you'll see like the pressure will be important in few places because like the three components, let's say I'm talking, let's say about the 3D case. In the 2D case, the pressure disappears because I'd be working with the vorticity, so I will not really be talking too much about pressure. But in the 3D result, the three components, they have different interpretations and they play different roles. And so I will not be working really with vorticity, and then the pressure will be important. So I will be talking about linear part of the pressure, nonlinear part of the pressure. So there will be a visible pressure that I have to talk about. But of course, at the end of the day, the pressure will be following the velocity. I mean, it will be slaved to the velocity. But it will have an important role in 3D.
Other questions?
I'm just asking in the regularity issue about the subjects, but if we assume more regularity, then we get a better decay of the nonlinear system. And I'm just asking whether the norm will grow as your regularity assumption is large.
So here, like if you take Sobolev, if you take S much larger, like let's say if you make S larger and larger, the gamma will not change. So it will not be, so either you are here or here. Like there will, as of now, okay, I don't know about like, let's say, intermediate thing between these two, for instance. So either you are in Sobolev, and then this is your gamma. Let's say if you are in 2D, or this is your gamma if you are in 3D. Or you go to the Gevrey that I'm giving there, like S bigger than 1/2. And then this is the gamma. So even if I improve the Sobolev regularity, I will not change the gamma.
But okay. If you decrease.
If you decrease it to the energy, I don't know. That's another issue also.
Other questions?
How do you define Laplace inverse?
Okay, so Laplace inverse, here you are, let's say here you are in the torus times R, right? So you are in a domain like that. So you can define it on the Fourier side. Okay, maybe I didn't. There are statements about zero average and so on that you have. What?
For every y, integrating x is zero for every y.
No. I mean, like you just need like the whole average to be. Okay. So here you are asking question basically about low frequencies. How we deal with low frequencies, right? So we need a small statement about. We need some weighted norm on omega in y. Let's say one weight, actually. We need like one weight so that omega decays well when y goes to infinity. And then there is an issue about the average. Like you can always assume that the whole average is zero. That's all. So the only issue is when k is equal to zero. When k is different from zero, k meaning the Fourier variable associated to this capital X. But that's one of the assumptions you can always make. Yes.
It's presumable that you can do it also for in 2D from surface quasi-geostropic with some dissipation. That looks like an active scale.
Yeah. I think there are I think there are possibilities of extending to many other. I know like for the 2D. There's the beta, I mean, you can include the beta effect. I mean, there are works also about including the beta effect you know, like this term coming from the Coriolis force. I think that's an easy adaptation, I think.
Okay, very good. Other questions? Well, I don't see any. So let's thank the speaker again. Okay.